on the relationship between the Islamic idea of human rights have been explored by Abdullahi al-Naim, who is a legal scholar in Emory University, Abdul Karim Sarosh, who teaches at Harvard University, Ibrahim Musa, Duke University, Irene Ho, who teaches at American University in Washington, D.C., Abdul Aziz Sachidinam, who teaches at the University of Virginia in America, to name a few. Fred Del Meyer, who is a philosopher and a Catholic thinker from Notre Dame University, finds that the interconnected relationship between religion and people provides a positive interplay, creating a concept of Islamic values, which he suggests can have a positive role in resolving human community issues. The exercise of Huquq al-Insan, which is based on free will of individuals, reaffirms the Quranic injunction to do good and avoid evil, which elevates humans to their true status. Encouraging victims to forgive the perpetrator, if possible, without losing sight of the crime that was committed, is similar to the Gandhian approach of condemning British colonial policies without blaming the English as a community of oppressors. Islamic restorative justice assumes that peace is possible after violence with a reciprocation of forgiveness, which is a victim's right to give or withhold. The victim's right to forgive the perpetrator allows for continuity of human societies, empowering it to move forward and away from excessive focus on the violence that is negative for human well-being. This shifts power from impersonal states, like the state and government, and offers an alternative vision for human development. In Pakistan, an effort was made by the Women's Action Forum to apologize on behalf of the nation to the women of Bangladesh for the crimes committed by the Pakistan Army. To my understanding, the gesture, although commendable, cannot be a substitute. Perpetrators must apologize and seek victims' forgiveness personally. In the subcontinent as a whole, there has been no public acknowledgement of the crimes committed by the armed men against non-combatants in 1971. Unless we are willing to engage with the outcome of armed violence, there would be no movement in the direction of reconciliation and forgiveness by the people. Beyond the individual admitting to their crimes, the states of India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh are ultimately responsible. They had led their armies on behalf of their national ambitions, and they must bear this responsibility. Thus, my suggestion is Huquq al-Insan cannot be reduced into a religious practice, but must be approached as a critical human language for an alternative discourse for justice in the present. In Pakistan and Bangladesh, the process relies on the moral force of rights that is inherent in the human condition, and the states of violation of the human right must be recognized for restoration by the state. It is not difficult to agree that the War of 1971 was one of the worst violations against humanity in the subcontinent. The event illuminates the traces of a frightful history that I outline in this presentation. We are afraid to look at it closely because it may mean seeing ourselves as both victims and perpetrators. Rather, we vent our anger at others and nurture the wound of suffering as a symbol of remembering. Without undermining the sacredness of that personal memory of victims, I would suggest that a story of victimhood must transcend the present impasse. The free and independent use of reason based on the ethics of humanity is a beginning step. Having worked with survivors of the war for several years and listening to their testimonial desire for justice, it is clear to me that the primary objective of regaining human dignity cannot be achieved without strengthening society in general and local culture of rights in particular. Clearly, there are no magic solutions that can materialize immediately and resolve the problems of the people. Therefore, my approach is to give priority to the internal cultural language of Huquq al-Insan that democratizes the process of seeking and granting forgiveness and leading to reconciliation. By devising local solutions that are incremental, one can address immediate short-term needs for moving beyond the trauma of violence while continuing to seek long-term ends to assure the violation of people's rights and dignities will not happen in future once again in the subcontinent. So this is what I had prepared to talk to you, and I now know you may have several questions, and I'm open to whatever you want to say.
Thank you. Do you want to take this?
Yes, Neil. Thank you very much. It was a very good presentation. Can you all hear me?
No, it's not turned on.
It's not.
Yeah, it's on.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you.
You can. Yeah. Right. I have very small three questions. One is, can you define peace in one sentence? Second, nationalism, feeling of nationalism and rebelling against the authority, are they not two sides of the same coin? Somebody for his or her country is feeling, that is nationalism. The other person who is ruling, that is going against. But they are the two sides of the same coin. And the third is, can the word humanity or humane behavior be implemented in a mass scale? Can it reach the word peace? Ultimately, in today's world?
Okay. Big, very, very big questions, actually. They're not little questions. Peace in one sentence. To boil it down to one sentence, of course, is really requires a clarity that I don't have. Nonetheless, I would attempt to possibly say that peace is not the absence of violence. It requires a continuous, peace does not come after violence. It is something that we have to nurture and be in it. It is an experiment that Gandhi had said, and I really take on the Gandhian approach in this case, is an experiment with yourself to find your own humanity. It's only then that you can understand the humanity of the other, which requires first to be, that means there's a difference between peace as an object and to be at peace with yourself. So first you have to find the peace within yourself to be able to find the peace externally. And so it is not that acts of the violence, that things should be all wonderful outside, and I can be tumultuous within. And that's a process. Nationalism and rebellion, are they the same thing? Nationalism, as far as I would understand historically, is a development of the 18th century. It is not that people did not rebel before the historical development of nationalism. So that rebellion is a demand for freedom, a demand for liberation, to find your human, to quest for a sense of justice that you set as your horizon in a very Derridean way. But nationalism is a construct, is an institutional build-up, which had happened after the French Revolution. So I would not consider it to be the same. Rebelling to get the dignity driven by a nationalistic approach, yes, they may have the same continuum, but you can rebel even against God. Is that nationalism? You know, so rebellion as a concept is a much larger concept than the small construct called nationalism.
I would like to differ here, because in our generation, what we personally saw, nationalism, like Bangladeshis, they felt it was their nation, it was their country, so they rebelled. Because they felt unjust works or unjust politics was going on in the country. Their portion, their share, their ideas were getting ignored. So they rebelled. They rebelled against the authority who were imposing all these rules over them, and called these nationalistic feelings by the people of the soil, people who came from that soil, or people who actually accepted that soil as their own country, as the rebellion. So they do come from which point you are looking at it.
Now, I totally agree with you that the second part that you sort of said, that the perspective is different from that of the ruler versus the one who is asking for rights, for justice, for social justice, that West Pakistan government has completely denied. And I won't even call it rebellion, because in that case, that rebellion becomes, like particularly when you look at colonial records that I do, it is really amazing. The language of rebellion is always about intransient. The problematic, the troublemaker. Here it is not a troublemaking, as you said, it is a demand for the right, a right to be absolutely a full participating member of the community that was brought together in 1947 and was called Pakistan, and it completely failed. That state completely failed its people. If you look at dictators that fail people. That's how I see it. If you read Campbell Smith's book, actually, that's an old book of 1957, and it's called Pakistan, a Muslim State? And he raises the question that, can Pakistan be ever a good state? And can it be a Muslim state? And it's that contradiction was really embedded within the quest for power and the claim that power must reproduce authoritarian regimes that only crush the desire of the people that constituted this nation. So I totally agree with you. But I would not even use the word rebellion because it undermines the quest for this, for justice. It's a larger concept than rebellion and nationalism. I find those things actually limit what are the issues that are at stake. And then you asked the question, can humanity reach, can we reach a mass scale? I was thinking about it, I keep thinking about it, and one of my constant companions in this whole research, has been, I will admit, was Hazrat Nizamuddin Awliya and Mevlana Jalaluddin Rumi. And I even did not write the book till I had the permission to write this book. And I was thinking about it this morning, and I actually want to read to you just one line of this. Last night, the Sheikh went out all about the city, lamb in hand, crying, I am weary of beast and devil. A man is my desire. They said, he's not to be found. We too have searched. He answered, he who is not to be found is my desire. So can it become a mass thing? Still a desire.